Supporting Newcastle United has brought me great joy and a sense of belonging, shared purpose and community, as well as the opportunity to watch the beautiful game at its beautiful best in that cathedral to football, St. James's Park. But it has also brought me deep despair and disappointment, particularly in the last few years. Now, I wanted also to present myself in my Newcastle team shirt, but I was told in no uncertain terms that that was not allowed, and so have settled for a Newcastle Libraries t-shirt with the city on it. Newcastle United is at the heart of our city, Madam Deputy Speaker. Unlike Liverpool or London, we have only one professional football team, and we are united in our support. And what support it is. Madam Deputy Speaker may recall that back when we had regional development authorities and investment in our regions, the North East tourism slogan was passionate people, passionate places. The passion of Newcastle is football. We have consistently high attendances, some of the highest in the league until recent times. The economy of the city is influenced by the success on the pitch. If we're winning, we're singing and spending. If we're losing, the gloom hovers over all our heads like individual storm clouds. It's part of our culture. If you move to Newcastle, and we certainly have unparalleled quality of life, so I recommend you all to move to Newcastle, but you will find it, and you will find it an open, welcoming and warm city, but whereas elsewhere you will get away with talking about the weather, in Newcastle you need to know how the tune are doing. It is part, Madam Deputy Speaker, of our mental well-being. 90 minutes spent at the Gallagher end would be enough to convince you of that. And this is not only true in Newcastle, as my honourable friends and fellow Newcastle United fans, the members for Gateshead and North Tyneside, can attest, and they would have liked to be here. Football is the lifeblood of many cities, particularly in the north. And that, Madam Deputy Speaker, is despite changes which have seen money, not fans, the driving force of football, thanks to the creation of the Premier League and billions of pounds from Sky. So whilst I will speak mainly to Newcastle United Football Club, its finances, its owner, much of what I say applies to football as a whole. Madam Deputy Speaker, since 2008, Newcastle United Football Club has been owned by Mike Ashley, who also owns Sports Direct, House of Fraser and a number of other retail businesses. In July last year, I presented a petition reflecting the concerns of fan groups, such as If Rafa Goes, We Go and the Magpie Group. That petition caught the attention of Mr. Ashley, something I had been unable to do as the MP for St. James's Park, despite writing to him to ask for a meeting. It's testimony to the power of Parliament that on Saturday, after announcing this debate, I was able to meet with Mr. Ashley. Madam Deputy Speaker, I committed to Mr. Ashley that I would make no personal attacks on him, and I will not be availing myself of parliamentary privilege to do so. I want to say to all fans that personal attacks on Mr. Ashley or his employees are wrong and hurt our cause. I shared with Mr. Ashley my concerns on financial transparency and funding, and he was passionate in defence of the investment he has made, and that he has not taken any money out of the club, he said, other than short-term funding that he put in on a temporary basis. This, he said, was in contrast to the period prior to his ownership. He also emphasised that he had made clear the club must stand on its own two feet and can only spend the money it generates. Well, Madam Deputy Speaker, to put it diplomatically, we disagreed. The meeting was open, frank and robust, with strong views on both sides. I hope to continue the dialogue. Indeed, this debate is part of that dialogue. It has to be, as I have still to receive any reply to my letter of last year raising a number of critical issues, which I've also raised in correspondence with the Secretary of State and the previous Sports Minister, the MP for Chatham and Aylesford. Mr. Ashley said the club can only spend what it generates. This is a form of austerity economics, one of which Tory benches would be proud. Newcastle United needs investment to reach its potential. Earnings have been hit by uncertainty and the bad feeling between fans and the owner. But even if we accept what he says, how are we to know what income the club generates? As the Secretary of State said in his letter to me, clubs are treated like any other private business. They must submit accounts to Companies House. Well, I am not an accountant, but I do have a master's in business administration. I worked in business for 20 years and I have studied corporate finance. I've looked at the Newcastle United Football Club accounts. I can't work out what's going on. Faith in Newcastle accounts has not been helped by comments made by Mr. Ashley at the Community Select Committee last December when he said, people cheat, that's what businesses do. And also, accountants are able, this is their job by the way, to move the numbers about pretty much at will. And that seems to be what is happening at Newcastle. Mr. Ashley's ownership of the club passes through four separate companies, Mash Holdings, St. James's Holdings, Newcastle United, and Newcastle United Football Holdings. In addition, there are dozens of other companies associated with the club and Mr. Ashley, and the managing director, Lee Charnley, has over 30 other directorships. And then Newcastle United Football accounts do not include a cash flow statement, although that is a requirement of reputable accounting. This would all seem designed to make it harder to follow the money and see what income is being generated. And I hope the Minister will agree that this is not acceptable, and specifically that she will commit to ensuring that the following income streams can be identified. Firstly, TV payments. They should be in excess of £123 million, but they are not reported separately. Secondly, merchandise. Mr. Ashley turned the club shop into a Sports Direct shop, but the revenues from Sports Direct do not go to the club. Thirdly, player sales. Now, the way in which the purchase and sale of players is booked and amortised is in itself arcane. Newcastle United is consistently reported as having one of the lowest spends on players in the English Premiership, and many estimates indicate the club has actually made a profit on player sales overall during Mr. Ashley's ownership. Does the Minister agree that we should be able to calculate that? Fourthly, advertising. Sports Direct hoardings are all over St. James's Park, and yet again, we do not see the revenue in the accounts. And finally, land sales. Next to St. James's Park is an area called Strawberry Place, which was allegedly purchased by Mr. Ashley from the club for less than it was worth. We don't know. It's not visible. What we do know is it's being developed for student accommodation. Selling this land stops any further expansion of the stadium, and fans believe that the profit from the sale of this land will not benefit the club. But how are we to know? There is also an issue around land and property apparently sold to companies called Project J New Cove 39 and 40, which appear to be connected to Mr. Ashley, but there's no evidence of any payment. Yeah. Madam Deputy Speaker, I'll give way briefly, yes.
Lady, seen Deloitte's Football Money League report that seemed to identify some of those incomes that you're referring to, such as £27 million for match day, £143 million for broadcast, and £32 million for commercial. Figures that we could only dream of for Walsall Football Club.
Well, I appreciate appreciate the Honourable Member's interest in Newcastle United, and I have seen the Deloitte figures and report that make Newcastle United the 19th richest club in the world. And my concern is how the figures are reported visibly for all clubs, but particularly in the Premier League, where there is so much money going around. Because the fact is, Madam Deputy Speaker, that Mr. Ashley appears to be able to move assets about between his privately owned companies at will, despite the club being a historic cultural icon and the other companies of somewhat less reputable status and longevity. So we don't know what income the club is generating and if that money is being used on the club. What is certain is that this transfer window, like the last one, is closing without money being spent on players or training facilities. Mr. Ashley's principal investment in the club has been in the form of loans rather than equity, presumably to protect his financial exposure. These loans are interest-free, which is good, but as loans, they can be called in should he need to. So the sustainability of Newcastle United depends on his other businesses being successful. And that leads me to Mr. Ashley's business practices more generally. The Bay Select Committee likened them to a Victorian workhouse, with employers being paid below the minimum wage. A dispatcher's investigation found employees were publicly shamed for talking, spending too long in the toilet, or falling ill, and lived in fear of being fired. And now Mr. Ashley says that he's going to save the high street. Forgive me for being somewhat cynical, having seen how he has saved Newcastle United. Madam Deputy Speaker, Newcastle United is an asset to our city. It is a cultural giant in our lives. I want to explicitly pay tribute to the fantastic Newcastle United Foundation, which uses the power and passion of football to do great work across the North East and is in part funded by the club, although again, this funding is not transparent. And the Premier League, you also use some of their vast wealth to the benefit of local communities, at least what can be spared from expenditure such as its £5 million farewell gift to departing Executive Chairman Richard Scudamore. But Madam Deputy Speaker, neither Newcastle United nor the Premier League consider themselves accountable to fans. And as many constituents have made clear to me, fans feel powerless before the slow destruction of what we believe in. Newcastle United is the beating heart of our city. We should be able to protect it. Madam Deputy Speaker, that goes to the heart of the matter. Why is it you can buy a stately home in the wilds of Wiltshire and you can't change a window frame, but you can buy Newcastle United in the heart of Newcastle and strip it of its assets without so much as an eyebrow being raised? Why is it that football is left largely to regulate itself when other businesses, from pubs to social media companies, must meet social requirements? I know the Minister recognises the importance of football clubs and the custodian role of owners. She said so in the recent debate on Coventry City. So will she now show that she will put recognition into action? Will the Minister launch an inquiry into the reporting requirements of Premiership clubs using Newcastle United as a test case? Will she ensure this inquiry answers the financial questions I have raised? Will she ensure supporters have a voice on football club boards as Labour has called for? Will she make reputable custodianship a requirement of club ownership, as the fit and proper person test is clearly not fit for purpose? Madam Deputy Speaker, it is with great sadness that I say I have come to the conclusion that football is broken. Its governance has not kept pace with its income, and money has won over sport. We cannot turn back the clock, but we can put in place effective regulation so that financial transparency enables the beautiful game's true splendour to shine forth once more.
I'll be listening also to supporters groups. The general cost of travelling to and attending games is something I know that must be kept under constant review, and my role will continue to look for a fair deal for fans. I appreciate that football is heavily reliant on broadcasting contracts, but they must consider their fans when it comes to scheduling matches and changes to kick-off times. I'm going to turn now to the fortunes of Newcastle United. Now, the Honourable Lady be keen to hear this. So, we can all agree, and this is one of our biggest and best supported clubs, and the city, adorned in black and white, is one of the most visible and wonderful sights. St James's Park, sitting loud and proud in the centre of the city, a city that loves its football club and wants the very best for it, that we heard today. And part of the case made today is that Newcastle United is simply currently in the hands of someone who is not really a lifelong fan. And if we look along many of our clubs, you would probably find plenty of owners do not fall into this traditional expectation either. But that does not mean that owners are not running the club objectively badly, or indeed in unsustainable lines, or without a huge interest in the club succeeding. Now, as the government set out in our response to the petition brought by the member for Newcastle Central last summer, to the best of our knowledge, Newcastle's owner is complying with all the financial reporting and ownership criteria that I ran through earlier, but I have a list of responses to come back to. And the club is also meeting its obligation to engage with supporters and discuss matters so important when it comes to the running of the club. However, that does not mean that Mr. Ashley or any other owner, for that matter, could not go further than simply complying with the league rules. There is always room for progress. Now, Mr. Ashley has made no secret that he is looking to sell the club. However, until such times, he remains the person responsible for its custodianship. Like every owner, his primary responsibility is to ensure the club is financially secure. And despite the concerns raised, I'm certain Mr. Ashley is shrewd enough to know that he should fully intend, if he wants to sell the club well, be in a position to realise its best value by looking after it. So to sum up, it is important that the issues of most concern to football fans continue to be heard, and I will be continuing to listen to supporters up and down the land about their concerns regarding ownership, and I will be meeting with the Unified Supporters Organisation on the 5th of March, and I will continue to work to hold the football authorities to account. We must ensure that there's continued assessment when it comes to the regulations that are in place. We must be in a place to continue to encourage good ownership. We must be in a place to continue proper financial reporting. We must be in a place to continue with meaningful dialogue with supporters. We must be supporting our grassroots, working with the Premier League, making sure that we have the pipeline of young footballers coming into the game. And I haven't mentioned women's footballers and other areas in terms of participation. So I take these concerns very seriously. I'll be writing to the Honourable Member on all of those points, and I thank her for the opportunity to respond to this German debate this afternoon. Thank you, Madam Deputy Speaker.